Come and dream with me.
Hello, welcome to What You Want to Watch, the Exposure Notes Premium Media Podcast. Every week we get together and talk about movies, TV, and online content and help you answer the question, will Denis Villeneuve do a practical nuclear bomb or a CGI nuclear bomb in his upcoming nuclear war movie? It's very up in the air. I'm your host, Ashley. Is it?
Well, I don't think you can. I think the nuclear act, right?
Maybe, but Nolan just did it practically. That's what I'm saying.
Kind of.
I'm your host, Ashley. Hopefully, join me today, Dylan Blight.
Nuclear Dylan Blight.
We'll do an atom bomb explosion. We'll be practical or CGI.
Yeah.
Probably CGI. But he does like doing things practically. What's the sudden interest in nuclear war? All right. What is everybody talking about?
It's crazy.
I'm sure this isn't a sign of anything.
No, it's fine.
All right. On today's episode, we're talking about what's in our watch history going on, some film news. Given this week's top three and giving some thumbs to trailers, we'll kick things off with the debut film from Dev Patel, Monkey Man. A film set in India where a young man is fighting in staged fight pits to make a living. It is aspiring to kill the corrupt police chief who murdered his family. Directed by Dev Patel, starring Dev Patel, written by Dev Patel, inspired by a lot of the Asian martial arts films he's seen and that kind of stuff. It's definitely a revenge film. Trailers looked really good. Dylan, what did you think of Monkey Man?
It's an absolute wild ride with a lot of problems, and I loved it. Like, it's such a, at times, splatter bomb of, like, just, this is the excitement you get when someone's a first-time director and just going, fuck it, I'll do everything I can think of. Because I just don't feel like there was anyone going, nah, maybe like save that for another movie, or maybe we'll like don't do that or whatever. Like, he was like, if I never get to make a movie again,
I'll have put every single idea that I can think of into this. Every piece of inspiration,
Which leads to a lot of pacing issues, weird editing choices at times, with like the transition from one scene to another, and I'm like, that was a whiplash, but whatever. But ultimately, it's hard to like, I appreciate all the effort and stuff he's got into it, problems and all, warts and all, for this one. And I mean, that last like half hour is just insane. Really cool as someone who loves martial arts films. So that shot, the overhead shot of the elevator opening and just a bunch of people in it, oh, that hits my spot.
I really enjoyed the film too. I think it does, it has issues. It's definitely a film of two peaks, whereas it's a case of building up to two different points in the movie, and then when the first one hits, it kind of falls off a cliff and kind of like it slows down to a halt, and we take a very long, extended self-exploration period that maybe we didn't necessarily need.
It goes for so long.
Yeah, it just kind
of like, oh, it's like it was like Return of the King. I'm like, oh, the montage is, no, he's still training. That's good.
I was fine with the training. It's the remembering the inciting incident in his life, which I feel like wasn't really necessary.
You get a flashback.
I don't think you need to spell it out. I think he did a good enough job.
Like, Let's tease it. Now show half of it. Tease it. Show the full thing, and then flashback to it several times. Yeah, the audience has seen it, so we can flashback to it.
Yeah, but when it's doing all the action stuff, fantastic. All the hand action is really cool. There's like, I feel like towards the end, of like the handy cam like got maybe a bit too shaky for my tastes. Some of the camera work and that kind of stuff. Dev Patel knocked it out of the park. Well worth the screw that needed to get surgically implanted in his hand to keep working. Charlton Copley has a really fun role in the film. Is the stage fight promoter. I wouldn't call it wrestling because they seem to be like,
it's hardcore wrestling.
It's like, okay, it's GCW, I guess.
It's, you know, blood sport.
It's blood sport.
Josh Barnett's blood sport.
Yeah, and there's, you know, none of the characters are really developed very much.
You know, other than him, I guess.
Other than him, I guess he has some sort of growth. You know, there's the female character.
Yeah, she shows that's up it. At the end. She does the thing. She's like, you know, I'm here.
I made, she says some choice. Stuff. I will say, this film has crazy, really, I was very surprised. There's fantastic trans representation, which I said to Buddy as I was coming out of it, man, this is going to piss off a bunch of right-wing people when they go into this big action movie, especially it's me, or listen, there's a bunch of trans empowerment in this movie. So I'm looking forward to seeing that. But yeah, also, it's interesting, you watch this movie and you go, oh, okay, the story is that Netflix got spooked into not wanting to release this on Netflix because it was thank pretty, God. Like, there was stuff around Indian politics, which Netflix has had a lot of trouble with anything that's even slightly outspoken against India's politics being released. And like, they'll just remove it from Netflix and like blacklist or whatever.
That well, I can't imagine not watching this in cinema.
Yeah, I mean, it all worked out, and apparently Jordan Peele got a good deal on the movies. Yeah. I mean, it so worked loud, out well for everybody.
Movie.
But yeah, I mean, you know, I think the some of the motivations of the bad guys and that kind of stuff, I feel like could have been explained more. But yeah. Really good. Action's really cool. Lots of blood, gore. Crazy fight sequences. There's a scene where he's running away and he comes across, he like bumbles into like a whorehouse and a guy comes with him and with an axe. there's some crazy stuff in here. So definitely worth checking out Monkey Man in cinemas pretty much everywhere now. Hopefully it's a big success. We get more Dev Patel films. All right, Dylan, you went out and watched The First Omen, a prequel to The Omen, something like that. I don't know. I don't care. I don't care, but I've seen, you know, obviously prequels to these horror movies are generally not well received, but I've seen a lot of people tweeting this weekend, oh, you need to see The First Omen. If you don't see The First Omen this weekend, we're not friends anymore. Is The First Omen worth ending friendships over?
I think it's that good, but it's pretty good. Especially for a horror movie prequel. Basically, the plot of this one is that, so yeah, it's before The Omen, and if you somehow, like Ash, don't know what the fuck The Omen is, I guess, it's about Damien, the son of Demon Spawn, and he gets like snuck into like a family, and then, you know, there's like 3-4 of them. Sam Neill shows up in like the third one. He ends up being like the president's son, so then he's like at the top of power basically by the third film, I think, or something like that. So this one, it starts, you've got it's really weird watching this, but this and Immaculate have so many like similar themes. It's crazy, and they're in the cinema at the same time.
People have been saying non-spoiler station, it's live and well in 20.
It is 100%. This movie starts exactly the same as Immaculate. It starts with a woman
with Sydney
arriving. starts with a woman arriving in a new country, getting picked up, taken to her covenant that she's joining. Exactly the same as Immaculate. After that, it's sort of different, but basically, while she's there, she's, it's a lot less weird than the church people that Sydney Sweeney deals with. But everything seems sort of fine, you know, much chill. There's like kids that stay at this place, get looked after and whatever else. She takes a liking to one of the younger girls because she's sort of locked in this room and told she's a bad kid. And she knows that she was... similar stuff happened to her when she was younger before she found God and all this stuff, and she was a bad kid and whatever, so she wants to look after her. Lots of weird shit starts then happening, and yeah, I mean, can't really spoil too much, but yeah, it leads basically right up to the, I mean, the movie ends basically right where the Omen starts. It like Rogue Ones it, which is a weird thing, which is a weird thing to say for a horror movie prequel, but it's sort of, I've never seen a horror movie prequel do what this does, which is just straight into the, literally they're like, we're going to ride this sucker right up until literally where the Omen starts. So that's cool for fans and stuff. I don't think that's like half the, maybe a lot of the reason people are enjoying it so much is because it, the movie doesn't go for a lot of the nostalgia moments at all. But then when it hits that, hits it home at the end by going right up to the film, I think for people who love the Omen franchise, especially that first film, that's going to be a cool sort of like reveal to how everything fits. Ties in and fits into place and stuff. Because for a lot of the movie, you're like, you can sort of try and guess how it's all going to play out, but it's cool to see it play out the way it does. They also, by they do a thing where they both tie it into the Omen while adding in a brand new mythology or a piece of the puzzle for this universe that is definitely for, if this is successful, which it seems to be going successful, that they would want to do a sequel for. And the sequel potentially would be set after all the other Omen films, I think, if I'm were to guess. But yeah, I thought it was really good. It has some, you know, it's very much like Immaculate. It's a slow build for a lot of it. Weird stuff happening, characters talking, playoff, and pays off at the, you know, the final act is not, I don't think anywhere near as intense as Immaculate's final act, but still very, very good. And yeah, non-spoilation. So alive and well.
All right. So I watched the new Apple TV Plus documentary series or two-parter. Steve Martin, a documentary in two parts, which if you are struggling to figure it out, is a documentary about Steve Martin. I feel like this is a very interesting project in that it's two episodes. Each episode feels very different to the other one. It feels like two different filmmakers made each documentary, but it's by the same guy. So the first episode is called Then, and pretty much follows Steve Martin's childhood to getting into stand-up comedy. And that's pretty much all that movie covers, from him trying to do a very absurdist kind of comedy, trying to do magic comedy, and, you know, struggling to make ends meet because it was very against the type of the time, to eventually like kind of finding success and being a massive comedian, massive comic star, all the way to him deciding to stop doing stand-up comedy. So the first documentary is very much a lot of footage, like a lot of, you know, archival footage of him doing stand-up routines, of his lot of photos and that kind of stuff, with very few like talking heads or like there's voiceover work and that kind of thing, but it's not like a lot of interviews and that kind of stuff or him in person or anything. It's all like pretty much told in archival footage form. Whereas the second episode, which is called Now, is very much Steve, his hanging around with Steve Martin and they're talking about his career. This half more focused on his film and TV career, from his big hit The Jerk through to, you know, him now working on Only Murders in the Building, his relationship with Martin Short, and then the themes he kind of feels like permeate between a lot of the roles he has or did during his acting career or he was drawn to. He talks about like him kind of being doing a lot of roles about lonely men, and which kind of ties into him not getting into like a very serious relationship until he's much older and having a child not till he's very much older. So yeah, I mean, if you're a Steve Martin fan, definitely worth checking out. If you're a fan of comedy history, definitely worth checking out. I think it's they're quite chunky episodes. I think they're like an hour and a half each, don't necessarily need to do it in one sitting. But yeah, I think it was a really well told, well structured, you know, series, you know. But yeah, I mean, the second one was probably more interesting because there was like more talking heads and more footage of him living his daily life. He's a big fan of poached eggs, apparently. And he just, yeah.
Just love a poached egg.
Love a poached egg. So yeah, check out that on Apple TV Plus. And then Dylan, you and I have both started watching Quiet On Set, the new documentary, documenting a lot of the abuses and hardships that were taken or struggles that were taken by place or by people who were working at Nickelodeon back in the 90s on a lot of the live action TV series. I'm only about an episode and a half in. How much have you watched?
3 episodes.
Okay. So, well, obviously this series has become like this massive cultural touchstone, I guess. Like, it's became like a viral, I don't want to say viral hit, because it's kind of, obviously it's upsetting subject matter too, and kind of scandalous, I guess, in a way. In very much documenting the failures of Dan Schneider, who was a prominent figure in Nickelodeon's live action team, who worked on shows like The Amanda Bynes Show and all that, and Josh and Drake. I don't know. I didn't happen to watch a lot of those shows just by chance. I guess I was more interested in the animated stuff or didn't have Nickelodeon at the time.
I love The Amanda Show.
I mean, I liked Amanda Bynes in movies that she was in, like Big Fat Liar.
No, maybe this is also like maybe our the few years difference between us. I loved watching The Amanda Show. I was like, maybe my first crush. I don't know. Maybe too young to know if it was a crush, but definitely loved that show. So I used to watch a fair bit of the Nickelodeon stuff. I didn't get to watch it all the time. I used to watch it when I went down to my Nana Pops because they had Nickelodeon like once a week. So maybe one day or 2 days a week sort of thing. I think it's a decent I'll put it this way. I think this is a decent documentary. I don't think it's a greatly... I don't think it's like an award-winningly produced documentary or anything like that. I think the subject matter being such a trove
newsworthy.
Highly newsworthy slash just not talked about, like it's this hidden anything that hits on that as the years and years and years as we go on from, you know, Me Too to now, the continued uncovering of dirt within Hollywood just becomes both shocking, unsurprising, and highly it's horrible to say, but just it's just you can't look away, right? You know, you got people talking about these horrible, horrible things that happen, and it's disgusting. And there's some absolute monsters talked about in this. By the time you get to the Drake Bell stuff, that's the big stuff that I think has made the news and stuff like that. What happened to him? That's what's in episode 3. It's a lot, but yeah, that's the way I put it. I think it's a good, decent doco. Nothing crazy as far as like from a documentarian perspective or even the way it's produced and edited. Like I think it's all pretty pretty straightforward, but the subject matter definitely carries it.
Yeah, I tend to agree. I don't think it's fantastically structured in any way. Obviously, you know, it helps that they've got a lot of the footage and they've got interviews with a lot of people, but then you've got like there's a lot of people who are like critiquing it from the outside that you don't necessarily, it's like why is your opinion on what's happening right now kind of the most needed, I guess, rather than the people who, it just feels like there's a lot of editorialism on top of it as well, rather than just, you know, just stating a lot of the facts, which maybe would have been the better option, you know. I don't think this isn't very entertaining, but it's engaging to watch because of the content, you know. I feel like I need to watch all of it. One, because it is such a talked about thing at the moment. Obviously it was delayed like it only just came here in Australia, and it's been out like weirdly. Feel like a whole month in the States.
But that's the thing, weirdly, the last episode, I looked on IMDb, the last episode, episode 5, only aired yesterday.
Oh, okay. It was, yeah.
So, I don't know what the release schedule was, really, but...
Yeah. Very weird.
So they dropped two episodes one night in America, March 17th, two episodes later, March 18th, and then episode 5, yesterday.
Mm.
So... Unless they did an add-on episode?
It feels like that's kind of what they were doing. I don't know. Mm. Yeah. The release schedule for this feels very weird.
Yeah.
And I feel like maybe... Yeah, I don't want to put words in. Don't want to say my... I'm speculating this last episode is kind of an episode like recapping the reaction to the actual series itself, potentially.
That could be what it is, yeah.
That could be what it is, so... So Quiet on Set, currently on Binge. You can check that out. So I watched a documentary that is currently on Disney Plus, Sperm World.
Cool.
So it's a documentary about men. It's a...
You just left it.
Yeah. So it is about...
Gherkin. Freezing the spams.
No, definitely not freezing.
Took a guess.
So it kind of revolves around this Facebook group in America that is trying to connect people who are willing to donate their sperm to women who want to have babies.
Right.
And it follows a lot of three different donors who have kind of a career donating sperm to people. One of them is in a couple with another woman who themselves are trying to get pregnant, but are unable to, even though he's got several children with a previous partner. And also, he's obviously donating to people his sperm to get them pregnant. Another man, he's like 65 years old and has gotten the desire to donate. In the documentary, it follows his... kind of connection with this much younger woman who's battling multiple cirrhosis, mm-hmm. I think, off the top of my head. And she wants to become mother. And it's kind of... there becomes like this weird blurring of lines in that relationship.
I've already got a question just before. So what's the difference between this and like actual like sperm banks where they like make sure that you're not getting sperm from someone who you're like third generation... related to and stuff?
Money.
Okay.
There is obviously, with sperm banks and that kind of stuff, there is massive costs. Is like a device they use is like the documentary is made by like the New York Times or something like that. So they go into the Facebook group and they put like up ask different questions into the Facebook group and get like a bunch of responses, and they use that for a thing. And like one of the responses is, why did you go this path and not down the sperm bank group? Money was a major one, but the other one was that people wanted to actually meet the person who was going to donate the sperm beforehand, which isn't the case in a lot of sperm bank situations. Mm. And I guess like you can also be a bit more particular. Like at the start, there's like requests for specific racial and ethical and ethnic and physical attributes and that kind of stuff. Like, oh, I only want sperm from redheads, or I only want sperms from Latino or black people, you know,
right.
That kind of thing. You've got these two, and then you've got a third person who's been donating for a very, very long time. He has over 100 children that he has fathered.
Put them work.
And he... He has a lifestyle where he feels like he needs to try and see all his children as much as he possibly can. So he works his job, but he also just pretty much couch surfs from parent to parent. So he can see as many of his children at the same time.
What's his job, though? How's he?
He seems to be some sort of teacher, like university teacher.
Right. Okay. But that means all 100 people live within a close vicinity.
No.
Oh, so how the fuck does that work?
I guess, you know, weekends he goes away to different parts of the country and like spends a night or whatever.
But usually, now I'm even more confused. Usually, people who want donations, they want, like, usually don't have anything to do with the sperm donor.
No, apparently, this way they want to like have some sort of form some sort of relationship. Or as part of the donation, he wants to form some sort of relationship. But I guess he is listed as the father on the.
So that's like part, part of his agreement.
I guess so, yeah.
With the other people.
It isn't exactly touched on a great deal.
Okay.
That element.
I'm going to watch this and I'm getting frustrated. All my questions aren't answered.
Yeah, I mean, this is a documentary that isn't focused on the answers. It's more focused on the actual people. Like, you're just kind of. It's very much a fly on the wall. It doesn't really judge these people a lot. Like,
I'm not judging. I just want to know the
No. What I'm saying is that the film takes a very non critical lens on these people, for the most part. Yeah, it's a very interesting watch because obviously these are very odd relationships that these people are in, and very weird. The dude who has 100 kids is just kind of, at one point he says, I'm not addicted to doing this, but it feels like he kind of is. He's thrown a birthday party for himself, and he's brought a bunch of his kids to the birthday party. And some of the parents there are pressuring him for sperm because they want to have siblings for their children.
Right.
So at one point he's hanging out. One of the kids wants him to go play in the jumpy castle. He's like, I'll be back in 4 minutes. He goes into the bathroom.
Hmm. He just has a test tube ready to go.
Yeah, it was a syringe and
yep.
Some sort of condom, you know?
Yep.
And yeah, he's like, oh, there's a woman ovulating in the other room. I need to quickly... It is wild at certain points. I mean, it opens up super awkwardly where it's like the sperm donor just comes into a hotel room with this woman. He's like trying to explain exactly how the process plays out. Yeah, and then the relationship between the older man and the woman is very awkward, made even more awkward by them, the filmmakers deciding, hey, you should read out these text messages you've written. And it's read out in the most terrible performance way. You know, just the worst way somebody could ever read something on, you know. Also, this dude is a guy who likes to do speech to text, which is
cool.
Yeah, he's a weird dude, you know. But yeah, very fascinating documentary. Not something I thought would be in discuss. Yeah, it's
how'd you end up watching this?
I'm like, what documentary is it coming out? You know, because I like to have documentaries on in the background while I'm doing stuff at work. I'm like, okay, this is interesting. obviously, it had positive reviews as well, and like that kind of stuff. So, yeah, just very. Yeah, it's just kind of like a fly on the wall kind of documentary for like a several month period around these people's lives. So yeah. Also very distressing, like obviously there's no regulation around a lot of this. Like we've seen some, like talked about that other documentary about the Dr. Death dude, the sperm donating thing, and like, well, what are you doing with, how are you keeping all these kids separate? What like ethical relationships, or like what ethics do these children?
I was waiting for crossing? The twist where you're like, yeah, the dude has a birthday party, invites all 100 of his kids, and a mum turns up and doesn't realize her daughter also got a baby from the same person. Because that was the fucking thing in that dude's thing.
Yeah, I know. They haven't quite hit that point either. Yeah. I mean, the other interesting thing about that dude is he has a very strained relationship with his mother, because she doesn't want to have anything to do with his 100 kids. He's like, I'm a good Jewish woman. I don't want anything to do with your weird family.
Fair enough.
So, yeah, very interesting. Check out Sperm World on Disney Plus. two things go great go together. All right, let's move into the mandatory Netflix segment of the show. Dylan, you've binge watched Ripley, the new Netflix series starring Andrew Scott.
Yeah, how good. Probably the best show I've watched this year, I think. I don't know what else I've watched this year. I think that's fair to say. So it follows the Talented Mr. Ripley, the first book in the Ripley saga. It is a very slow burn in all the best ways, thriller, detective, mystery, with an absolute tremendous performance from Andrew Scott, who just does so much with this character in a lot of times where it's just all him by himself quite often. And just, I've never seen someone do so much with a silent performance, at least in recent memory that I can think of, than what he does with this character is so good. Everyone else is really good as well. Dakota Fanning and Johnny Flynn are the other two main characters in it. Not too much to talk about without getting into spoilers. I mean, if you've watched the Matt Damon movie,
yep.
The plot's the same. It's a lot spread out a lot more here. This is a million times better than that movie, so I'll say that. I think one of my favorite things it does, other than just giving this character so much time, like the first episode, seven episodes roll in, Europe, varying degrees of Europe. First episode, New York City, before he comes out and goes to Dickie Greenleaf, whatever his name is, his house. Because the plot of this, I guess, the basic plot for people who are somewhat confused, the basic plot is Guy, Andrew Scott, Ripley, is for some reason tracked down by Dickie Greenleaf's father. He hires Tom Ripley because Dickie and him apparently met at one point, and he just plays along. Dickie doesn't even recognize him when they meet up. He says, "Hey, my son's staying abroad. I can't get him to come home. I want him to come home. Can you go try and talk to him to get him to come back home?" And he said, and he goes, "I'll pay you for your time. Like, it's a job to go there, but also obviously it's a free trip to, I can't remember the exact place, but it's a free trip to, you know, a brand new country and all these sorts of things." So of course he says, "Yes, I will do that." And then when he gets there, he slides his way into becoming best friends with Dickie, and things go from there. I would say when it comes down to, there are some episodes where it's just Andrew Scott just doing things. It's so just the way it's played out, and the pacing of it is so well done. I thought it was fabulous. And I think the other thing that stands out for this is black and white. It is beautiful. I think this is one of the best shot things I've seen in quite some time. I assume it's all actually shot mostly in places that are either where they're supposed to be or very close, because it all looks very, Vienna and where all these other places. This, the main place they're staying, I can't remember the fucking city or whatever it is, but there's a lot of time there. It's just all the steps they walk up and stuff, and you see several characters, including Ripley when he gets there, struggling with going up the many, many steps and stuff like that. But yeah, I highly recommend. I thought it was fabulous.
All right. Well, that's everything in our watch history. Let's move into the little bit of film news we got this week, because CinemaCon is about to start this week. Probably has started by the time this episode comes out. So a lot of news will probably break during that period. But one piece of news that did catch my eye and thought would be enough to generate discussion, this one from Variety. Warner Brothers is going back to The Matrix. The studio announced that a fifth Matrix movie is in development. It'll be the first installment without Lana or Lily Wachowski as directors. Instead, the Martian screenwriter Drew Goddard will handle filmmaking duties. He will also write the script and produce with his partner at Goddard Textiles, Sarah Esberg. Lana Wachowski, who helmed the most recent Matrix installment, Resurrections, is attached as an executive producer. It's not clear who from the Matrix universe, Keanu Reeves and Carrie Ann Moss, have anchored all of the prior movies as Neo and Trinity, while Yahya Abdul-Mateen II, Jonathan Groff, Neil Patrick Harris, Priyanka Chopra Jonas joined in the most recent iteration, will return. Plot details haven't been revealed, but Warner Brothers Motion Pictures President of Productions Jesse Ehrman teases that the story will advance the fantasy world without straying too far from what made the series a success. He says, Drew came to Warner Brothers with the new idea that we believe would be an incredible way to continue the Matrix world by both honoring what Lana and Lily began over 25 years ago and offering a unique perspective based on his own love for the series and characters. The entire team at the Warner Brothers Discovery is thrilled for Drew to be making this new Matrix film, adding his vision to the cinematic canon that Wachowski's spent a quarter of a century building here at the studio. Dylan, what were your initial reactions to this Matrix news, and is making a Matrix 5 a good idea?
I think on paper, I hate the idea, right? That should be unsurprising. Especially following the Matrix 4, which does so much meta-narrative around the creation of a sequel. And it just seems ridiculous, completely... like the self-awareness or lack of to greenlight a sequel given the story and everything just is very weird. That said, I do like Drew Goddard as a director. So I feel like I am at least open to hearing an idea is where I'd say I'm at with this. If they'd announced some other people maybe I don't like as much, I would have instantly wrote this off. I'm open.
Wow. I'm kind of surprised by your openness in this.
Yeah, I could tell you where. You're ready for me. You thought you'd bring us in to
get like, son of a bitch. Why do they continue making three sequels to
You thought shit. I was just going to yell and scream. Yeah.
Yeah. So. Nah,
too tired for that.
Yeah, I mean, my initial reactions were also, why. Do we really want another Matrix movie that isn't directly made by the Wachowskis? Do we need a sequel at all, I guess? Drew Goddard, obviously, because he has an impressive resume, obviously directed Captain in the Woods and Bad Times at the El Royale, wrote The Martian and wrote Cloverfield.
I guess his writing credits are his...
And obviously he worked on a lot of... He's worked mostly in the world of television on Daredevil and Lost and Alias and Buffy and Angel.
I think it's the cabin in the woods being so self-aware and like meta that gives hope. I don't know.
So yeah, I'm open to the idea. What would I actually want from a Matrix sequel? Do I want it to be more Neo and Trinity? I'm not sure. I think I'd be open to... anything really, I guess, I mean, clearly the interesting thing here is that they're making a Matrix, they're moving forward with anything Matrix at all, obviously the Matrix Resurrections was enough of success to warrant, believing the franchise is worth continually investing in. But yeah, if it was, the adventures of Jesse Henwick's character and new Morpheus and stuff like that, I'd be down. If we're going to, pull the veil back even more, like kind of explore more new people getting taken out of the Matrix or like realizing they're in the Matrix.
This is the problem and the reason that the problem with the Matrix is as the plot moves forward, you have to spend less and less time in the Matrix. It only makes sense from a narrative point of view because in the first film, they set up the whole idea of being escaping it. However, as the original trilogy continued on and they spent less and less time in the Matrix, everyone hated it.
Because they were callers when they're inside the Matrix.
Yes, but it's just this trap, right? So, yeah. And now if they do a sequel to the fourth one after they sort of saved a lot of the I don't know, it's just... It's a weird structure where it just doesn't make sense to spend more and more time in the Matrix when the film sets up that's where we don't want to be. That's where we're trying to get away
from. Yeah, that's not where we're supposed to be, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess. And if you're going to make a Matrix movie, you need to go into the Matrix, though. So, I mean, it would be a bold choice of, like, okay, we're going to make a Matrix movie that's, you know, completely in the real world, you know? Barely going to deal with, you know, being inside the Matrix, whatever. Would you be on board with a prequel of sorts of, like, the origins of the Matrix or something like that, if you wanted to try and tell that story?
Nah, why do I care?
That's fair. I'm just spitballing ideas, that's all. Okay. I think the other key thing that kind of gives me confidence is he's gone in here with an idea. Like, he's pitched an idea for the Matrix franchise rather than them going, hey, we want you to make a Matrix movie. Come up with something. You know? As long as he's got some sort of clear vision. My only other concern is that I don't think he has the same visual flair that, you know, the Wachowskis have. But, you know. If Lana is, don't know, Lily is involved, you know, in some way, maybe she can give him some pointers. Would you want Keanu and Carrie Ann Moss back?
I feel like that's highly dependent on the story. So I don't want, yeah.
Okay, well, that's all the news I've got for this week. Let's move into giving some thumbs to trailers. Of course, you can find all the trailers we're about to talk about in the show notes below. Kicking things off with Turtles All the Way Down, directed by Hannah Marks, starring Isabella Merced, Cree Ciccino, and Felix Millard. When a 16-year-old struggling with obsessive-compulsive disorder reconnects with her childhood crush, she confronts the possibility of finding love and happiness in the face of mental illness. Dylan, what did you think of trailer for Turtles All the Way Down?
I'll go one up, one down. I'm going to say for this, as someone who's read the book, this trailer has nothing to do with the plot of the book unless they've completely changed the plot of the book. So, there's a romance in the book, but it's not the main plot line, whereas this trailer just makes it seem like that's the entirety of the plot line. So, yeah, I'll go one up, one down, because I actually really like the book, so a little bit of me is like, oh, it's cool, I'm looking forward to watching this. But, yeah, it was very weird, because I clicked play on the trailer, I'm like, and it finished, I went, where's... And I don't want to say, because I'm like, I don't know if it's meant to be a twist now. I don't know, anyway.
Okay. Yeah, I'll give it one up, one down as well. Like, I have not read the book, so I've got no context, so I'm just basing it off this trailer. I think, you know, they're kind of maybe a bit too heavy-handed with her obsessive-compulsive disorder, you know? As if she feels very one-note, I guess. Yeah, because, you know, obviously she's obsessed with bacteria and germs and that kind of stuff, which isn't a bad trait to have in a person post-2020, am I right? So maybe it just plays a bit different now. but I definitely didn't get the impression that it was a story about romance, more a story about the friendship between those two girls more than anything else. But
well, yeah, I'd say the friendship between the girls and something else is the main plot line of the book. John Green, have you watched any of his other?
I watched the one that you didn't watch because you didn't want to cry.
Fault in Our Stars.
Fault in Our Stars.
Yeah, still never.
So I feel like everybody watched Fault in Our Stars.
Yeah, I told you, I read the book, that was enough. I'm done.
You're like, no.
No, that's enough.
No, I didn't watch Paper Towns.
Wasn't that good. But remember, I really liked the TV show.
The TV series Looking for Alaska, yeah.
Yeah.
Didn't get around to finishing it yet, but maybe one day. But yeah, all right. This one is coming to Max in the US on the 2nd of May. There's currently no release date or place here in Australia. It's a toss-up. Or binge, who knows at this point. Next trailer, Bodkin, created by Jez Scharf, starring Will Forte, Siobhan Cullen, Robin Cara, David Wilmot, and Chris Whalley. A group of podcasters set out to investigate the mysterious disappearance of three strangers in an idyllic Irish town. But when they start to pull the strings, they find a story much bigger and stronger than they could have imagined. Dylan, what did you think of the trailer for this series, executive produced by the Obamas?
Yeah, wild, hey. I'll go one up, one down. It's got podcasters in it, so relatable.
You're pro.
You know, so points for that.
Like anything that gets more podcasters, right.
It's always points, you know. Go watch Kevin.
Brings us closer to getting a podcast, the movie made it best.
Damn right. I think mystery, small town vibes, actors I like. Just trailer wasn't like super, super grabbing me, but I was already intrigued when I remember reading about this, I don't know, a while ago, a month or so ago. So trailer didn't change my opinions. I was like, yeah, that looks about what I thought.
I'll go one up, one down as well. You know, concept's interesting, characters look really good. I'm maybe not as funny as I thought it would potentially be, you know.
Just because of
Will Forte? Yeah, well, you know, his pitches is a dark comedy. And there's like, unless you're laughing about murder, I don't know. I mean, or people dying. Funny,
where the lady's like, are you the podcasters? Yeah.
And so close it off. Yeah. It's classic. Which isn't totally relatable. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, it looks intriguing. I definitely check it out when it releases. Islands, you know, that's a bit different. Bodkin is releasing on Netflix on the 9th of May. Next trailer is for Dead Boy Detectives, created by Steve Yockey, starring George Rextrew, Jaden Reverie, Cassius Nelson, Brianna Cuoco, Ruth Connell, Yuyu Kitamura, and Jen Leon. Two teenage ghosts work alongside a clairvoyant to solve mysteries for their supernatural clientele until a powerful witch complicates their plans. Dylan, what do you think of this trailer for this series set in the Sandman universe?
Explain this to me.
It's written by Neil Gaiman.
That's about it, isn't it? There's no other real... I didn't miss something, did I? There's no real tie-in other than them saying it is. Right?
They first appeared in The Sandman.
All right. I'm going to be honest. Double thumbs down for this trailer. Nothing against the premise or the idea in a show might be good. I thought this trailer was just... I didn't like it. And they're playing too hard for a certain fan base when you're playing MCR and the way this trailer's put together. No, it didn't work for me. Sorry. Double thumbs down.
Two thumbs for me. Fuck you. Give me as much black credit as you can shove into anything, camera. I mean, it's a little on the nose. I'll admit. But yeah, I mean, this is my kind of series, supernatural-esque, you know.
Sad boy shit. Yeah.
Sad boy shit. These two ghosts just don't want to die or go to the afterlife, you know. Mm. I think there's interesting ideas written. Like, one of them apparently has already gone to hell and escaped. I think, you know, the clear tie-in to Sandman is Kirby... The person who played Death in the Sandman is in this as well.
Right, okay, cool.
Kirby Hope-Baptiste, I think? Off the top of my head. That sounds right. You know? And it's them solving mysteries. What more could you want, you know? I mean, some of the visual effects are not like top end, but you know, they're effective. I'm definitely keen to check this out. This one is coming to Netflix on the 25th of April. Next trailer is for Babes, directed by Pamela Adlon, starring Alana Glazer, Michelle Buteo, John Carroll Lynch, Oliver Platt, Sandra Bernhard, Stephen James, and Hasan Minhaj. When Eden, an aggressively single woman, gets pregnant from a one-night stand, she turns to her best friend Dawn, a married mother of two, for help. Dylan, what do you think of this trailer?
Double thumbs up. Looks great. Looks very funny. Love the concept. the chemistry between the two, at least within the trailer and everything, looked really, really good as well. Our boy Hassan's in it. Double thumbs up.
Yeah, two thumbs up from me. Obviously, it was a big hit at South by Southwest, so I was already keen, and based on the trailer, I'm very excited. I think, you know, it looks like a fantastic giving birth comedy, am I right? You know, pregnancy comedy. When was the last time we had a good one of those, you know?
Been a while.
You know? Yeah, very funny, Ilana Glazer. It's very funny in this, Michelle Berteo. The chemistry between them and the friendship, you know, set up really well. Yeah, just lots of fun gags. And then, you know, it ends on that note of that giant needle, which very, very funny. And just her resignation to having to accept it while also being freaked out is a perfect way to play that scene. So, yes, Babes is releasing in the US on 17th of May. Currently, no Australian release date. Last trailer for this week.
Three thumbs Cuckoo. Up. Sorry, what? No, continue.
Cuckoo, directed by Tilman Singer, starring Hunter Schafer, Gianna Boulthard, Martin Kruska, Jesse Henwick, and Dan Stevens. Reluctantly, 17-year-old Gretchen leaves her American home to live with her father, who has just moved into a resort in the German Alps with his new family. Arriving at their future residence, they are greeted by Mr. Koning, her father's boss, who takes an inexplicable interest in Gretchen's mute half-sister Alma. Something doesn't seem right in this tranquil vacation paradise. Gretchen is plagued by strange noises and bloody visions until she discovers a shocking secret that also concerns her own family. Dylan, what did you think of the trailer for Cuckoo?
How good. So good. I've watched it several times. Banger. Best trailer of the year. Done so well. Creepy shit. Loved it.
Why is it so good?
Just, I don't know, the pacing, the build up, that moment where he's the shadow of the lady on the bike and everything the first time you watch it. Like, just the and then you get through to that last part, just with Dan Stevens talking over the background as it starts to do a bit of a cut between the speeding up events of the presumably the back end of the movie and everything. I think it's just cut really well together. And then, like, Hunter Schafer, that part where she's like yelling out, just be like, that's fucking weird, like, or whatever. Like, I think it was just really well put together. I think it's great.
Yeah, I have to give it two thumbs up as well. It's definitely a very intriguing trailer. Do I have a desire to watch this movie? Not really. But am I excited to find out what the hell that thing is that they've? What's the secret behind everything?
Human evolution, yes. Maybe.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, interesting setting, interesting characters. Obviously, you know, Hunter Schafer looks like she's going to play an interesting final girl. Just the weird, there's that shot of the like bed in a bend, like an empty pool or something like that. Very creepy. A lot of creepy imagery.
Creepy shit in this.
And yeah, that's just great. Don't ride your bike in the dark, you know?
No, sorry. Like how we got Dan Stevens in Godzilla vs. Godzilla Kong, where he's like, like wearing a Hawaiian shirt, and just like having a great time. And then this, he's like playing creepy fucking scientist.
Yeah, he's having all the range this month. Got range this year. All right. So yeah, Cuckoo is releasing in its native Germany on July 18th, releasing in the US on the 9th of August. But there's no Australian release date.
Fuckers.
I know. Let's move into this week's top three.
Definitely in the top three.
And in honor of Fallout, the TV series releasing this week, this week's top three is top three post-apocalyptic movies. All right, Dylan, what's your number three?
Number three, now I've wrote down four here in case you like veto one, but... So I've gone with 28 Days Later as my first pick. Now this could fall into this is where I'm like, zombie movie. Is it not a zombie movie? It's not a hard
apocalypse is a very broad range. Yeah. There are many apocalypses.
There are many types of apocalypses. And I could have easily just picked a bunch of zombie movies, but then it's like, I can't do that. 28 Days Later, probably one of the best modern day well, the best modern day zombie movie, I guess it added something brand new to the genre, which was the idea that zombies could run. And it's not even a joke. That's literally the yeah.
Yeah, and they ruined zombie movies for
everyone. They ruined zombie movies for everyone, yep. They were like...
Now we're scared of zombies all the time. You know?
Yep. Danny Boyle directed this and then was like, that's it. That's people sitting at home going, fuck. Like, George A. Romero sitting at home.
What are we
going
to do?
Fuck, they fucked me. Like, how the hell am I supposed to make another zombie movie now? Can't. Promise. But yeah, obviously this is getting a sequel or a third entry. Yep. Killian may return. I don't know if they've confirmed.
I think it definitely is. You know, he's attached. Cool.
Yeah, so I think the second one's good. I don't think it's anywhere near as good as the first one. The first one just has such a vibe. Dude literally wakes up. Do you know the pitch for this movie?
It's no. 28 days after the zombie apocalypse kicks off.
Yeah, so it's 28 days later after the end of the world, basically. But the Killian Murphy's character, the movie starts with him waking up in the hospital. He's been in a coma. So he comes literally out of coma. No one's in the hospital. And then you get all those really cool cool scenes that in most of the promotional material for the movie with him just walking down the streets of London, across the bridge and everything like that, and there's just no one anywhere. And he's just woken up from a coma and it's like the world's over.
Oh, so it's like The Walking Dead.
I'd like to clarify that this came out before The Walking Dead.
Yeah, I don't.
But yeah, and then zombies and people and...
Or did it? Did it come out before the comic?
I believe so, yeah. I think okay. So. Yeah, number three for me.
All right. My number three, post-apocalyptic movie, Wall-E.
Your list is going to be terrible.
The movie about a bunch of robots that, you know, it's a robot that's found one piece of plant life on the destroyed planet Earth who encounters a bunch of robot humans. It's been a while since I've seen Wall-E. But it's a fantastic movie, beautifully animated, and shows how terrible humans could be in a very different direction in a post-apocalyptic world. Dylan, watch Wall-E. Dylan, what's number two?
This one, like, do I... So, I've got... I don't know if I want to go for what I put. Nah, fuck it. I'm changing it.
Whatever. But, you know, we're very, you know. I'm changing You've it. Stretched limits of what a no, lot no, of no, these I'm categories have been in the past.
I feel like it falls into the category, but I'm just like, I don't feel like. So I'm going to be honest. I'm going to tell you, and then I'm going to move on. So I had Matrix down, but I don't feel like I'm watching a post-apocalyptic movie when I'm watching it. So I'm overriding it. I'm going to replace it with Snowpiercer.
Okay.
Bong Joon-ho's Snowpiercer, very cool movie. It's stars Chris Evans. He's him and a bunch of people on this never stopping train, and the train set up like a end of the world. The whole planet's frozen over or whatever. So just constantly moving through, just on the train tracks, and just as the world outside's fucked. But the train's set up with the class system. So literally, Chris Evans and friends start at the back of the train. They're in the lowest class economy, and then the movie's about them fighting to the front to kill Tilda Swinton. 10 out of 10.
As you do.
Yep.
As most movies are about.
Yeah, hell yeah. Why not?
Right, my number two, Zombieland. It's zombies, but fun.
Zombies are always fun.
Zombies, but funny, you know? Great ensemble cast, fun action sequences, and, you know, it's your... Really, it's infomercial on how to survive the zombie apocalypse. You know? Tells you a bunch of rules to live by. So we're all prepared. Zombieland. It's got layers. Dylan, what's number one?
Number one, got Mad Max Fury Road.
Dylan, my number one Mad Max Fury Road.
Very good. It was tempting to write like Mad Max and be like, just give it to the first one. But I'm like, the first one isn't actually a post-apocalyptic movie. The first one is hold on, you haven't seen any of them, have you?
No, not yet. Not I'm yet. About to start my watch.
Oh, are we going to do as a thing?
We could. I mean, we've got all the stuff on our plate, so...
No, I think we do it as a thing, because I've held off my rewatch, assuming you'd want to do it as a thing.
All right, so well...
I purposely haven't done a rewatch, so anyway, we'll work that out after this. So first Mad Max, though, isn't post-apocalypse. It's like sort of like during
It's during the actual apocalypse.
It's during the world going the shit, but like it's not... Like the apocalypse doesn't happen. And then the sequels, obviously, all during the apocalypse. But Mad Max Fury Road, one of the greatest movies of all time. There's nothing really bad to say about it. It's fantastic. You can watch it a million times. It's so enjoyable. One of the best experiences I've ever had at a cinema. It is the ultimate end of the world movie. Bunch of weird people, cars, violence, dude on a fucking hanging off a thing playing a guitar with fire coming out of it. You know, like there's wacky shit. It's great. I love it.
Yeah, I agree. Still fantastic crying. Movie. It's absolutely crazy. Fun story that I don't know if I've told on this before. Like, I was at Supernova 1 year, or well, whatever year it was about to release. And they were showing, like, they were doing, like, yeah, they were doing, like, a preview, or, like, a behind the scenes, like, or, like, showing the first footage from the movie. Mm. And not a lot of people were filing in to go see this.
Wild.
This thing. Like, it was reasonably full, but it wasn't like lines everywhere, you know? Mm. And we kind of all went in, and then we all came out, like, changed. And, like, kind of feel what like we had to spread the gospel. One of the major chase sequences, I think.
Okay. I find it very interesting, because I thought, until Mad Max Fury Road came out, So, you know, like, there's an element, and I feel like as you get older, you can understand how it's different, but, like, when you're growing up, if my dad showed me something, I assumed that other people's dads would have showed them that as well. Now, I don't know if that sounds weird, but, like, does that make some sort of sense? As a kid, you're like, well, surely, like...
everybody's seen Ghostbusters. Everybody's seen Back to the Future.
Like, that's sort of mentality. So, I got shown Mad Max.
Everybody's seen all the Alien movies.
Yeah. I got shown Mad Max when I was too young. Right, my mum hated it, but my dad showed me lots of movies when I shouldn't have been watching it. So I grew up watching these movies on VHS quite a lot, the first three, and got an inbred hatred for the third movie from my dad as well. So, you know, the first two classics, he loved them. He even read the book as a kid when he was in high school that the movie
hates Ted Turner though.
True. Yes. So in the when Fury Road was coming out, like my anticipation from the announcement was like, I could not fucking wait. So then when the movie released, and I found out, and like friends I had at the time had never seen a Mad Max movie, I'll talk to people, they're like, I've never heard this movie. I thought it was just such a, like, if you lived in Australia,
you're obligated.
Just you've like seen Mad Max, like Max Rockets Hanksky, which is his real last name, which I don't think they ever mentioned again, is an Australian icon. I would icon. Not
mention again.
You know, it's one of those things I like, I shouldn't ever want to watch it. But everything you just said makes sense, because I think, that Mad Max was a popular franchise. And weirdly, the third movie, which I think most Australians I hate, but in America they loved it because of Tina Turner and like California Love, and then you've got that whole Dr. Dre's new Tupac music video and everything that's like all set there, and they love that vibe of the third movie. But until this movie came out, blew the franchise up. So I'm really wondering how well the new one will do, because this one was a like not slow burn, but you know, it came out, everyone's like, this is the shit, you gotta go watch it. And then everyone went and watched it. It did really well worldwide. But I'm like, does that now mean everyone will go watch the new one and make it a like mega box office surprise number one hit of the year?
Yeah.
You know? Don't know.
It's definitely going to be interesting to watch. Here's an interesting question. So I go like scan a bunch of articles around all the questions that I posed, like trying to get inspiration and that kind of stuff. One of them suggested that one of the best post-apocalyptic movies is Children of Men.
Yeah.
Would you consider Children of Men a post-apocalyptic movie?
It is, because it's apocalypse, right? Because no one else is being born. That's the whole thing.
Is it post?
I guess,
or is the apocalypse happening at the time, you know?
Yeah, I guess that's the...
Because children are technically still being born, so I mean... Spoilers.
No, they're not.
What do you think they're carrying...
Yeah, well, apart from the one, that's the that's the whole point of the movie. Yeah. I know. I feel like post-apocalypse is everyone's dead and there's no movie because there's no characters left. So within the confines of that movie, the apocalypse is that
just movie. A bunch of old people like trying to watch them live out their last days.
Like if I was doing top ten post-apocalypse movies, Children of Men would be on my list for sure.
Yeah, it's a fantastic movie.
Yeah.
All right, Dylan, this week, what do you want to watch?
Good question. I don't know because I haven't updated the calendar. Fuck. you fucking got me. Hold on. You do yours. What's yours then, motherfucker?
I mean, number one, Civil War. Let's go.
Oh, that's true. That's out. Yep.
Captain America, Iron Man. Let's go round two. No.
Civil War 2, baby.
It's, yeah. Alice Garland's new movie. Maybe his last movie. set in an American war that apparently pisses off all Americans. They don't believe it would actually happen, but it probably will be able to happen.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, let's get excited for that. And then, Fallout.
Is that this Fallout week?
Comes out Friday.
What?
The first episodes.
What the fuck? Yeah, I think I'm actually, I'm just on the same picks as you, which doesn't actually happen often. Civil War and Fallout. Not much else going on.
I mean, in that case, I want to shout out Robot Dreams, the Academy Award nominated animated film that's releasing in Australian cinemas this week.
Yeah, in that case, I want to shout out Late Night of the Devil, Australian horror movie released in cinemas this week.
All right, let us know what you're excited to watch this week by going to explosion.com/Twitter or jump to Discord at explosion.com/Discord. If you want to help us out here at What Do I Want to Watch, leave us a review on Apple Podcasts and Podchaser. Leave us 5 stars and you can leave 5 stars or just tell people about the show. And if you've enjoyed this episode, thought it was worth $1, head on over to our Ko-fi page at explosion.com/support. Thank you very much for listening. Until next time, keep watching stuff, I guess.